Tonight on Daredevils Live, shattering the records. Gear up for the most explosive night of entertainment and television history. Over 60 of the most spectacular, most amazing, bone-crushing thrill rides you'll ever see. Witness fearless daredevils put their lives on the line as they launch their cars through the air, attempting to shatter the world record for distance. A battle for the best, a competition between life and death.
I'm the one who's going to pay if there's a mistake.
Then, watch as adrenaline-pumped daredevils push nitro-powered speedboats to the limit. It's a quest to set a new world record on the water. But one wrong turn could cost them their lives.
I'm going to take this boat and jump in front of anybody who's ever jumped a boat before.
Plus, discover the agonizing power of twisting metal. Daredevils driving past human boundaries as they attempt the impossible. Will they shatter world records or just shatter their bones?
Life done, you can't achieve anything. You have to see what you get.
30 years ago, America watched as the world's most famous daredevil, Evel Knievel, broke almost every bone in his body on the Las Vegas Strip. Tonight, live, the world will watch as Captain Robbie Knievel tries to shatter the world distance record. To do it, he'll have to overcome his biggest competitor.
My biggest competitor would be death.
The world's greatest daredevils, performing acts of outrageous courage. Some will win, and some will lose. It's an explosive night of destruction. Daredevils Live, shattering the records.
We are live from the Tropicana Resort and Casino right in the center of the Las Vegas Strip. Yeah, come on, let's go, Tropicana, get it going. We are about to bring you the wildest night of network television you have ever seen. I'm Joe Buck, along with my co-host, Ron Pitts. Live directly behind us, Captain Robbie Knievel is getting ready to perform the most dangerous stunt in all of sports. We will be attempting, and he will be attempting, a new world record by jumping his motorcycle farther than any human being in history, including his father, the legendary Evel Knievel.
I tell you what, Joe, if he pulls this off, I don't think anybody is going to ever break this record. Now, he'll be attempting to jump over 30 limousines. You see them lined up right down there, a distance of over 230 feet, no net, just a 200-pound motorcycle and plenty of guts. Believe me, plenty of guts. Now, you have to reach a speed of about 90 miles an hour, 95, in order to get to 30 feet of height in order to make this jump. Needless to say, Joe, I think we're going to witness a piece of history here tonight.
And if that weren't enough drama for you, this show is jam-packed with daredevil stunts, including three more world record attempts that pit man against machine. We're going to witness a record-setting attempt at a car jump, more than the length of a football field, a world record attempt at a speedboat jump, and probably the most bizarre stunt I've ever heard of, a guy who will attempt to spiral his 4,000-pound car three times in midair before landing upright.
If he lands at all.
Landing upright.
Landing at all is a miracle, I think.
Which I guess is a little more dangerous than folks are normally used to seeing on network television, Ron.
True. Or driving along the freeways in L.A.
Absolutely.
Whatever you want to say. Plus, we'll see more than 60 other stunts, many of which went terribly wrong, just in case you didn't realize that these stunts can be very dangerous.
All right, it's time to check in on our world record daredevils. First, out to the Orleans Hotel, where Spanky Spangler is getting ready to try that crazy triple spiral. Our colleague, Alan Massengale, is there.
Joe, this stunt is so dangerous it has never been attempted before. Daredevil Spanky Spangler will continue a tradition he started nearly 20 years ago, and that is to attempt to do the impossible. He will launch his car 200 feet in the air and spin three full rotations. Spanky Spangler is called the original fall guy. He has set world records for high falls on fire, and also for long distance car jumps, like this 232-foot world record into Arizona's Firebird Lake. But Spanky likes to combine stunts, establishing new world records, like this head-on sky crash at the Houston Astrodome. And when it comes to jumps like the suicide spiral, well, no one has tried more. Spanky has made it around once. He's almost made it around twice. But to set a new world record, he'll have to spin three times. No one has ever done this before and survived. Spanky is going to take off on this pipe ramp, traveling faster than anyone has ever gone before. And he has to do it perfectly. There is only a 3-inch margin for error. The world record for this stunt is 2 complete spirals. We'll see later on if he can pull it off. Right now, let's check in with Kevin Frazier, who's with the king of crash, Brian Carson. Kevin, what's the mood over there?
Things are tense here in the parking lot of the Orleans Hotel and Casino. A lot of folks wondering if daredevil Brian Carson can do the impossible and execute a 300-foot plus jump through a pair of uprights. Here's the deal. Carson will drive his car up the ramp and through the first upright, fly across the football field, and hopefully he will make it through that second pair of uprights. As for his landing, well, it'll be a crash, but that's okay because Brian Carson is the king of crash. Tonight's world record stunt is guaranteed to end in a crash, and this will mark Brian's 2004th professional wreck. That alone will put him in the Guinness Book of World Records. Brian's 2000 crash was in 1996, and until tonight, it was his most amazing. He drove off a 10-story Laughlin, Nevada rooftop at 60 miles an hour and crash-landed onto a bed of cars below. He was lucky to get out alive. Tonight, Brian Carson will try to do the impossible, a 300-foot plus jump between a pair of uprights. Now, Brian holds the record for this kind of jump, so I guess he's qualified to break his own record. The only concern is that Brian make it through this alive.
Here in Kissimmee, Florida, veteran movie stuntman Cort Hessler is getting his powerboat ready to break the current world record boat jump of 121 feet. This is one stunt everyone is holding their breath for. First, there's only so far you can stretch these world records. And secondly, this stunt will be attempted on the water. And whenever you do a stunt on the water, it adds a series of unpredictable elements of danger. The most dangerous element is the wind. A boat traveling at high speeds can be lifted right off the surface of the water and then slammed violently back down. The second is the smoothness of the water. Any variation in the chop, the difference in the height of those waves, can cause problems with control. Overcorrection of the steering could spell disaster. Add to that the fact that Hessler will attempt this stunt at night. The chop will be difficult to read. His depth perception will be reduced because of the strong lights. Everything is going to have to be perfect. The wind right now has died down. Earlier today it was quite blustery, but stays like this, conditions will be ideal. Wind is critical in most world record stunts. How are those Las Vegas desert winds? Let's check in with Ron Pitts.
Well, Mark, I got to tell you, all week long, Robbie's been trying to figure out the wind. And this El Nino thing, you know, it's been playing havoc all across the West Coast. Now, yesterday we had a little rain, but right now the weather seems pretty good, so I don't think he's going to have to make too many last-minute changes. But the last time he came out here, he said I might have to move the landing ramp up a little bit. Whatever I got to do to make sure I can make this jump. And you got to remember, this is a guy who's going after the world record. His father, he jumped from 17 limos. He's going for 30 limo jump right now. That's a long ways. And don't worry, Robbie Knievel's a guy who's been jumping for a long, long time. Here's Robbie in 1994, leap day in Los Angeles. The flight was perfect. The landing was not. Robbie attempted to break the world distance record here in New Jersey at Atco Raceway. All he ended up breaking were his wrists. His current sanctioned world record distance jump was set in Florida on July 10th, 1993. A 10-foot ramp, a world record 223 feet jump. Tonight live, Robbie will attempt to break two records. Number one, his distance mark of 223 feet. And his father's limo record, if he's successful, he won't only break his father's record, he'll shatter it by more than 17 limos.
All right, Ron, thank you very much. As this crowd gets ready for what should be a very exciting night, this crowd is getting electric, everybody getting ready as Robbie Knievel prepares for his jump, a jump that you will see live as it happens. But first, let's go over to the Orleans Hotel and Casino, where Alan Massengale is following Spanky Spangler on his world record quest.
The tension is mounting here as we near showtime at the Orleans. The crowd is anxiously awaiting the moment when Spanky Spangler comes roaring down this 850-foot stretch at 80 miles an hour in his 1978 Monte Carlo and launches off that pipe ramp. It's going to be an explosive moment. Now, this ramp setup that Spanky designed is all based upon this yellow line and had to be specially constructed to get around the obstacles posed by performing a stunt like this. First of all, his takeoff ramp is 10 feet high, but he added a 5-foot high pipe extension. No stuntman, Daredevil, or any other person for that matter, has ever launched a car off a combination ramp like this. And it's those last 5 feet that are so critical. This pipe that will send his car off is only 3.5 inches wide. Try and hit a 4-inch wide strip that you can't even see while traveling 80 miles per hour. It can't be easy. It'll be amazing just to see Spanky Spangler try this stunt. He's done rotations before, 1 and 1.5, but he needed to get up to a speed of 50 to 60 miles per hour. But to hit what he calls the sweet spot on that 4-inch pipe at 80 miles per hour is almost impossible. We're starting off the evening with the most wicked, most violent, and most outrageous world record attempt. The crowd here can hardly wait. But Ron and Joan, I don't think they fully understand just how dangerous this stunt really is.
Well, I'll tell you what, it's called gravity. Now, when Spanky goes off the ramp, he's gonna be shot through the air. It'll feel like he's pulling about 3 or 4 G's. And that's what makes this stunt so dangerous. He's gonna try to fly almost 200 feet through the air, so his speed has gotta be real high, about 80 to 90 miles per hour. Now, if he mishits the pipe ramp by just 1 inch, the friction will slow down his car. He could miss the mile of cars that are gonna catch him below, and that could be deadly for Spanky.
This is a combination stunt, speed, distance, and rotations. A triple suicide spiral. Alan, it's so dangerous, no one has even attempted this before.
But that's what sets Spanky apart from other daredevils. He compounds his stunts. Amazing thrill rides that are always on the edge of danger. No question that the most bulletproof daredevil in the world is Spanky Spangler. With 20 years of experience planning and performing daredevil feats, Spangler has earned every cut, bruise, and broken bone. Spanky started out as a stuntman, fist fights, falls, but the slow pace of Hollywood wasn't his style, and there was a war going on.
When I went into service, I went airborne, and I was in this special force. I was a Green Beret.
Spanky returned from Vietnam a decorated soldier. His military career prepared him for real, live performances.
When you're doing live stunts, you can't cheat anything. What you see is what you get. So I always say, the only thing I can guarantee is a crash.
Spanky started crashing from unbelievable heights. He's jumped off towers, cranes, even helicopters. Some call him the original fall guy because he's jumped so many times.
I was doing high falls, then I had to add something else to it. So I had a moving target below me, and I got in a helicopter, and we flew down a runway, and I jumped out of the helicopter and landed back in the truck, when the truck was going like 44 miles an hour.
This is one of the most amazing stunts ever attempted. There are so many variables. He must gauge the exact speed of the semi-truck. He has to factor in the speed of the chopper, the speed of the wind. One mistake will cause a deadly outcome. Spanky's target is 70 feet long and only 8 feet wide. He's ready to go. He did it! This startling daredevil act launched Spanky to the highest level. No one could compete with him, so he decided to shift his gears.
I just have an instinct. I always say that I was God-gifted to do one thing, and that's to do stunts.
So Spanky put it into overdrive. He wanted another world record, so he went for the long-distance car jump. Firebird Lake, Arizona. Spanky will try to break the current world record of 208 feet. And he did it. In fact, he shattered the old record. He went 232 feet. Only catch is, he's underwater. He has a special oxygen mask, but not for this long. He's been down 3 minutes. And up he comes. He did it. Let's take a look at the replay. A perfect launch for Spanky. Everything going well until impact. And you'll see that his breathing equipment is knocked away from his face, leaving him in serious peril.
Now I'm underwater. I have no oxygen. It's dark. I can see about this much light out of one door. I'm upside down, so I got everything going against me.
But Spanky is a survivor. He lives through the longest stunt of his career.
Most of the time, a stunt only lasts a couple of seconds. This stunt lasts for 3 minutes and 18 seconds.
In a quest for quick thrills, Spanky experimented with new modes of transportation. But Spanky still wanted more, so he started combining stunts. A car jump into a pile of stacked cars. A 200-foot car drop from a construction crane. A long-distance car jump while on fire. And if that kind of danger wasn't enough, Spanky came up with his notorious air crash. Here at the Houston Astrodome, he performed this stunt not once, but twice. With fellow stuntman Randy Hill, Spanky set up a stunt that no one had tried before, launching two cars off ramps to meet head-on over a catch basin of other cars. The combined speeds of the cars created the force of a head-on crash at 110 miles per hour. All this and no airbags.
I like jumping cars and stuff. People like that, and it's great impact at the end of it, and it's pretty violent looking.
But nothing can compare to the violence of the pipe. Jumping a car off a pipe ramp at 50 miles an hour creates one complete spiral. Jumping a car off a pipe ramp at 65 miles an hour creates almost two spirals. No one has ever survived a pipe ramp jump of 80 miles an hour, but Spanky is going to go for it.
I mean, you can shoot one straight up and spin them. That's pretty easy. But when you're shooting straight out and trying to spin a car, it's very difficult.
Difficult? So far, it's been impossible. But if anyone has the guts, the will, and the experience, it's the man who's performed over 22,000 stunts. Daredevil, Spanky Spangler. Spanky Spangler is here at the Orleans Hotel for the most dangerous stunt of his life, the automotive triple spiral, the suicide spiral. You have to be willing to face death to even attempt it. He's held the world record for distance twice. Now, he's going after a new world record. And Joe, he's getting ready for his pre-jump checkout.
All right, well, thanks, Alan. You folks get the idea. Spanky might be a couple of white tigers short of a full Siegfried and Roy show. It's just about time for our first world record attempt. While Spanky is starting his final prep, we're going to take time out for a commercial break. Next on Daredevils Live, Spanky Spangler is going to go for an automotive triple spiral, the suicide spiral, a stunt no one's ever been able to do before. Then, the king of crash, Brian Carson. He's going to try to fly farther in a car than any man has ever done before. And, of course, we've got the son of evil, Captain Robbie Knievel, when Daredevils Live, Shattering the Records, continues. Coming to you live for a night of amazing thrills from the world's greatest daredevils. Ron Spanky Spangler is about to attempt that new world record and try the triple suicide spiral
What the heck is that?
I know all about this stuff. I've seen my wife do it in our car. It's really pretty easy. The best way to describe it is let's take a look at some of Spanky's old tapes of doing some of his pipe jumps. Now, you can see he needs to hit it perfect. The pipe is only about 3 inches wide, and if you stop the tape right there, you can see he's got to hit it straight on. Now, that's good. That's a good shot there. The alignment is where he wants it. He gets whipped up. The G-force is pretty much feels like about two G-forces. Now, when he goes and he tries a single spin, he's going to hit the same way. Once again, the hit is perfect. And then the double spin, the gravitational feels more like three G's on this one. And then he comes with the spin. So the key, I think, Joe, is he's got to hit that pipe right. But I got to tell you, the last time anyone tried to go over 100 feet and spiral a car three times, the attempt failed. The car hit the pipe at a bad angle. The pipe ripped the car in two, and the stuntman was hurt. He did survive, Joe, but he was hurt bad.
And he was very lucky. Many pipe jumps have had fatal endings. We're hoping for a perfect hit tonight. We'll pick it back up now at the Orleans.
Joe Spanky is making a test run, one final check, his last chance to make any changes.
Ready on that little dry run. May have taken a little more than he thought. He thought he had a couple extra inches there at the end of that parking lot.
Well, all he was trying to do was just test out his speed. He knew he had to slam on the brakes, and he did that. Everything's okay now. Let's see if he can do this. And the key is he's got to hit that pipe right. You can see he's going to get that speed up.
Our in-car camera shows how Spanky is strapped inside his car, wrapped around by a protective roll cage. He's also wearing special protective gear. Although with what can happen in this stunt, I doubt any of that would protect him from a catastrophic landing. Okay, Spanky says he's going to go for it. He's got the 350 horsepower engine on a 78 Monte Carlo roaring. Everybody in the crowd is watching. And there he goes. Instead of left, he almost missed the ramp. He landed on the pavement instead of his landing area. Whether Spanky's okay, only time will tell. His men are there. They're looking in. I can't see any movement. Wait, there's a thumbs up from one of his crew, but I don't know if there are any injuries. Paramedics coming over to check on him. Joe, it happened so fast here on the scene. Oh, my. Did Spanky do it? Is he okay?
Alan, obviously the first concern is that Spanky is all right. I have to say, in real time, it looked like a world record.
Well, I tell you what. The problem is he over-rotated. He went about a half turn too much. Now, see, he's picking up speed here. He makes the hit, but he veers off to the right a little bit, and he's out of control. He was supposed to spin driver side down, but he ends up going driver side up and lands on the roof, which is, of course, the most dangerous way to land. There goes the Monte Carlo, all 4,000 pounds of it, one rotation, two. Now the impact, you saw that. That's a huge impact. I'll tell you, Spanky's one lucky man to even survive that one.
Well, absolutely no doubt about that, Ron. Right now, let's go back to the Orleans with Alan Massengale and new world record holder, Spanky Spangler.
Well, here he is, Spanky Spangler, who just set a world record. He's safe and sound, but oh my, he didn't hit the landing area. What happened?
Well, when I was coming to my approach, my steering went out. So I was at the point of no return, so I just stayed my foot on it, and I knew it might roll to the side when I caught it, and I started spinning. All I guaranteed was this crash when I came here, though.
Spanky, you went the opposite way off the pipe ramp.
Right, right. My steering was pulling me to the right, and after you committed to the ramp, there's no change. I mean, you got to go for what you got. That's why we have the good safety crew here. We had everybody back and everything went safe.
So as you hit the ramp, you knew that you just had to go for it. What were your thoughts?
Well, I was just coming to my ramp. My steering was pulling to the right real bad. I just held everything I got to try to pull it back. I couldn't pull it around, so I just hit the pipe. And I just held on because I knew I was going to have a hard time hitting the ground.
Tell us about the landing. You know, you wanted to land on your wheels. You landed on your roof. Talk about your feelings as you hit.
Well, I tail drug a little bit, so that took a little bit of the impact out. And then I got under the roof, and then I went into the slide. As long as you slide out of it and stay out of it, then you don't take as much impact.
A little bit of concern for you inside the car. The crew was on hand real quickly. Were you stunned?
Yeah, well, everybody, you know, we expected. I've done quite a few pipe rolls. I've probably done like 25 of them. And I've always hit my car. This is the first time I've ever got off the wrong side of my pipe. Hitting the pipe, you only have 3 inches right or left, and I was way far to my right.
Would you do it again?
I'd do it again, but I tell you, I'd check my steering next time.
Okay, Spanky Spangler, what a night. We are still a little breathless here at the Orleans as Spanky Spangler has set a new world record. Let's go to Joe.
All right, Alan, thank you very much. That's the kind of night we have in store for you here, folks. Congratulations to our first world record breaker, Spanky Spangler. Spanky, thanks for being with us here tonight.
I think it's a good time now to remind everybody watching this that these are stunts. These guys are very highly trained, experienced stuntmen. They are professionals, and by any means should you not go out and try to duplicate one of these stunts, because it could lead to serious injury.
It's one of those do not try this at home, right?
Do not try it at home.
Well, that's one new record for the night. We are live, coming to you from the Tropicana Resort and Casino on the Las Vegas Strip to see Captain Robbie Knievel attempt to set a new world record motorcycle jump. Robbie is in his trailer getting ready, and we have a special camera in there with him. Robbie, can you hear me? It's Joe Buck and Ron Pitts.
How you doing, Joe? Hi, Ron.
We're doing well. The amazing technology is we have a chance to check in with you. How are you feeling at this point, about an hour or so away from your big jump?
I was just thinking, I was looking for another motorcycle jumper. Hoping they get my dad out here pretty soon. He crashes better than I do.
Robbie, Ron Pitts here. Tell me, why this particular jump?
Well, I guess I put my foot in my mouth again like I always do. I do that all my life, you know, just like Spanky and a lot of these other stunt guys. We're always looking for something tougher, and I'm 25 feet further than Caesar's Palace. Well, actually 50 feet further on the gap distance. I'm at 198 feet. And my landing ramp's 100 feet long. I don't know how far I'm going to go tonight. I'm going to get out there and make practice runs, and however I feel. I know it's going to be chilly after the sun goes down here, and I'm just going to go for it. I'm committed. You sign a contract ahead of time. This is nothing to screw around with. I've had friends killed. I've had friends paralyzed. My prayers are with them and their families, and I hope I can continue on for another 5 years.
All right, Robbie, thanks for your time. Good luck to you tonight.
Thank you.
No doubt that we are all pulling for Robbie Knievel. We'll be back with Robbie later. Now let's join the action in Kissimmee, Florida, where another daredevil will attempt a new world record. Mark Thompson is on location in Central Florida, where we know they've had some rough weather and problems with tornadoes, and we hope everything's going to be okay. But right now, you're there for all the action. Mark?
Action and a lot of tension. We're in Kissimmee, just a stone's throw from Orlando, Florida, and Disney World. Over 6,000 people have jammed the seawall to witness this world record speedboat jump by veteran movie stuntman Cort Hessler. The current record is 121 feet. Cort is confident he can break that record by 20 feet, flying over 140 feet. Now, normally Kissimmee is a sleepy Central Florida town, but this town is rocking for this world record attempt. The crowd has been gathering all day long here on the shores of Lake Toho. The scene resembles a gigantic tailgate party on an NFL Sunday. People have come from miles around just to witness this world record attempt by Cort Hessler. Earlier, Hessler and his stunt coordinator, Artie Maleshi, had hoped to try a series of practice runs, but severe winds gusting to over 40 miles an hour make it impossible to determine exact speeds. The wind and rough water were too big a factor in a stunt that needed exact calculations.
The worst scenario that can happen to me is if the boat blows over backwards. If a gust of wind comes in or the boat hits funny in the ramp and I go over backwards, there's nothing I can do. I'm going for a ride. The boat's going to land on top of me and we're going to have problems.
Problems that in the past have caused serious injury to boat drivers. If the wind gets under the front of the boat lifts off, up, into the air, and then flips down on top of the driver. If Cort does not hit his ramp perfectly, the boat could roll, disintegrating when it hits the water. Hessler is 26 years old and lives in the Orlando area. He's going to attempt to break the current world record of 121 feet. His ramp is custom built, 50 feet long and 5 feet tall. It has a V shape that acts like the barrel of a rifle. A design that will help him fly straight. The launch and landing areas are extremely narrow on the lake. The audience is only 100 feet to his right. And to the left, hundreds of boats have lined up to view the world record attempt, which adds still another dangerous element to this stunt. The man in charge is Hollywood stunt coordinator Artie Maleshi. His credits range from Miami Vice, Waterworld, and Speed 2. Maleshi has been prepping this world record stunt since November, over 4 months in the planning. The goal? Well, it's for Court to fly past the white marker, which signifies the current record of 121 feet. I'm here with Court Hessler's stunt coordinator, Artie Maleshi. Artie, I've been telling everybody that you guys go way back. Give us a sense for that relationship and how it's built professionally.
Well, we could do that back a lot of years, and we started out as just friends hunting and fishing together, and he's been in the entertainment business for a while, and all of a sudden he became my assistant, learned he's doing stunts, and now he's pretty much my main guy.
What things should we watch as we see the stunt unfold live here tonight?
Well, basically, there's not everything to watch, just the boat making the jump, but it's a flat trajectory of the boat, that the front end isn't up in the air too high so that it doesn't flip over backwards.
Is that the biggest risk to the stunt?
Absolutely.
Good luck, Artie. I don't want to stand in the way of you helping Cord out. We wish you guys the very best tonight.
Okay.
It's taken 5 days to build that ramp. Tremendous planning. That's why I wanted you to meet Artie. Artie's the guy who, with Cord, has done a lot of that planning. So, believe me, Court Hessler is not taking this lightly. His life is on the line tonight.
That's right, Mark. With so many things that can go wrong, you have to say it takes a daring man to go up against odds like that. Stay with us, because when we come back, we'll see if Court Hessler will be our second Daredevil stuntman to break another world record.
Next on Daredevils Live, it's a distance no human has attempted to jump with a boat before. Witness Daredevil stuntman Court Hessler try the impossible. And later, he's called the King of Crash, Brian Carson. He holds the world record for autoflight, but that's not good enough for him. He wants to fly farther in a car than any man has ever done before. Then, he's the son of evil, Captain Robbie Knievel. Journey with him through the moments of impact. And the moments of glory. When Daredevils Live, Shattering the Records, continues.
This is Joe Buck, live from the Tropicana Resort and Casino in Las Vegas with Ron Pitts for more Daredevils Live. We're just getting ready to see Daredevil Court Hessler's attempt to jump a speedboat farther than anyone's ever gone before. Mark Thompson at Lake Kissimmee, Florida. How's Court Hessler doing?
Court Hessler is a pro, Joe. If there was anything that wasn't quite right, Court would call this jump off. He's gone through his final checklist with his stunt coordinator, Artie Maleshi. So far, everything has the green light. He'll be hitting that ramp of between 70 and 80 miles an hour, jumping 140 feet through a 60-foot fireball. It isn't exactly your everyday boat ride, but then again, some people just can't seem to do things the easy way, and I guess that's how you might describe Court Hessler. and the sounds of this stunt.
I don't have much reverb.
That's okay, that's okay. Don't worry about it. Come ahead. Come ahead. All right, so we're doing what? We're doing 60 miles an hour.
60.
And change, right?
A little over.
Okay, you feel good about the center line? You got the lights over okay?
Everything's good. We've got the lights dialed in, so they're not bothering me. I'm good to go, man.
All right, man. We're going to blow the pyro right as you're coming off the ramp. And I'll see you on the downside.
See you on the other side, bro.
Keep that white side up now. Adios.
Adios, guys.
What? We're ready.
You heard them. We're ready. We have two minute cameras on board the boat with Cort, as well as wireless microphones. So you will see and hear everything as if you were riding along on this world record stunt attempt. Cort must reach a minimum speed of 65 miles an hour to have a chance at the record. No one has ever jumped a speedboat off a launch ramp at that speed. The current world record of 121 feet is marked by this white buoy. We have placed an underwater digital camera at the 145-foot mark. A world record spot is marked by where the front of the boat first touches the water. Even if Cort flips over backward, the spot is determined where the front of his boat hits. Emergency crews are in their place. The final cue will come from Artie.
Okay, are you ready? Are you ready, Cort?
Yeah, 10-4, ready to rock and roll, bro.
All right, guys, that's a big action. Come on. Here we go.
This is Joe back in Vegas, and yes, the official word is that Cort has jumped 139 feet, 18 feet farther than the old world record. Ron, we just saw Cort Hessler do what most people would have thought impossible. I mean, having that big crash at the end, the big impact, but having the control to maintain the boat and stop it, how'd he do it?
I'll tell you what, the impact, first of all, was huge. That boat took a big hit. The double hull is what impresses me the most. It held together. It looks like Cort and Artie Maleschi, they planned everything right down to the last detail. All the months of preparation paid off. Cort Hessler set a new world record. He did it safely. He did it professionally. And when you set up a stunt like this, you hope and you pray that everything goes as planned, and it did.
Well, we understand that Cort Hessler's coming back in before he gets back to the dock. Ron, let's take a look at the replay.
Well, Joe, obviously, timing, speed, angle of takeoff, all that stuff is key. He's got to get it right. And you see he's getting his speed up right here, and it looks like he hits it right on. And if you can do that, you're halfway there. He's in the air. That's a big boat going a long way. It starts to gunnel a little bit. He's going off to the left. There's the landing, the huge impact coming up. Wow, you saw his head there just go off to the side. You could tell that impact was bad. That black thing in the back was his engine going away. I mean, he went from 60 miles an hour to a dead stop. That's like hitting a brick wall.
So as Cort Hessler comes back into the dock, we know that he has family there. His mother is there. And I'm sure if you're Cort Hessler, that's the first person you look for when you get back to the dock. There's his mom, the hug with his mother. He has just set the record with that boat jump. That's down in Kissimmee, Florida, while we are in Vegas, and we will be going back to Kissimmee in just a moment. Again, let's rejoin Mark Thompson.
Cort and Artie, Cort, an amazing ride. Were you surprised by anything? Because I'll tell you, you had our hearts and our throats on shore.
Man, that was a ride. I tell you what, hitting the ramp was nice and smooth, but the boat kind of started dipping down to the left, and I thought I was in trouble. You know, I thought the boat was coming into the wall.
When you hit the water, you're saying the boat didn't do what you expected?
No. I went into a bad, what we call a G-turn, which was just spun the boat out real quick and threw my motor off, and it kind of threw me out of the seat into the bottom of the boat. But I haven't seen the playback yet, but I think we got it.
You're about to see it before we see it, and the new world record. Artie, from your vantage point, was there anything that surprised you?
Oh, yeah. I was definitely surprised to see the motor go flying off the back of the boat.
That was not part of the plan,
no,
huh?
Not at all. But it didn't matter as long as he was safe. I mean, it was a heck of an ending, I can tell you that.
Let's take a look at the replay, and then, Court, I want you to just take us through it step by step, what was going on in your head.
All right, this is my approach to the ramp. It felt pretty centered to me. It felt like it rode up the ramp pretty smooth.
What a shot. That was like...
Court, you owe us a camera. Unbelievable. Really terrific. What a thrill for us to see it. And it's interesting that it all happened for you in the blink of an eye, so that you perhaps thought you were in more danger than you actually were.
I did. I really thought I was way out of shape. I thought I had problems in the air, and I just tried to steer out of it, and I really didn't have to.
We know that meticulous planning went into it, but I must tell you, what a thrill. Just an instant of thrill. Everybody on the land, we watched it, and it was a great, great treat. Congratulations, Corey Hessler. World record. Art Maleshi, all the best. Congrats. All right. That's it. Two very happy guys here tonight, Joe. Back to Las Vegas.
All right. Thank you very much, Mark Thompson. That was truly amazing. Well, that's two new world records, and the night's still young. We have a very, very special introduction to make to you here tonight. Tropicana, are you ready? Are you ready? This is now known as Robbie Knievel's father. Much more than that, the American Daredevil. Put your hands together, Evel Knievel. Evel Knievel, first of all, that is a beautiful bike. That is a beautiful motorcycle.
Thank you. That is a limited edition Signature Series custom motorcycle. It was made for me. It's one of 500, and it's made by California Motorcycle Company in Gilroy, California, and I'm very proud of it. It's beautiful. We're going to make about 3,000 of them.
Evel, I know that there are a lot of things that we need to talk about, but there's something that you want to get across to the people watching along the network, along the Fox network, about the kids out there and about how dangerous these stunts are that we're watching tonight.
Yes, I would like every child that's watching this show tonight to know that Robbie nor I, either one, and I'm sure I speak for Fox Television, we do not believe in the words no fear. We don't believe in that. Robbie has been riding a motorcycle since he's been 6 years old. He's 36 now. After 30 years of practice and becoming the best professional jumper in the world, he now believes that he's ready to tackle something like this. I don't care whether you're skiing, snowboarding, riding a bicycle or a motorcycle or racing a car. If you have no fear, you're thinking the wrong way. You have fear and you live a good life and enjoy it for as long as you can. Practice makes perfect, and remember, if you fall off, you're never a failure as long as you try to get up. That's what life is all about. All of you remember that.
I think you say it very well, and I wonder your feelings as Robbie gets ready to tackle a jump that you never made. I wonder what's going through your heart and your mind as your son is about to take on this jump, and how you feel now as compared to the time before you made some of your tremendous jumps.
Well, I never did jump this far. I remember dreaming one night that I might be able to jump 21, but I never ever dreamt that I might try to jump 30. This event tonight is kind of like a ski jump. If the wind is right, and it catches Robbie under the stomach when he gets up in the air on that motorcycle, and he floats the distance, lands on the landing ramp over the entire fleet of limousines, he'll have done a wonderful job. And if he falls a little bit short, it's just because he didn't catch it right. A ski jumper has to depend on the wetness of the snow, the wax on his skis, and the wind. And really, when you jump a motorcycle this far, this is what you have to look out for. I wish him the best of luck. I hope Godspeed, and I wish him that he hopes he makes it.
Evel Knievel, thanks for your time, and best of luck to you and the entire Knievel family.
Thank you.
The legendary Evel Knievel. Well, you just heard a little bit from some of Robbie Knievel's support staff, his dad. We'll be back with Robbie himself, who will attempt to break his father's world record jump. Kevin Frazier, who's following Daredevil Brian Carson. Kevin?
Joe, right now, Brian is checking out his car. It's a vintage 1969 Chevrolet Chevelle SS. It's a muscle car, and inside it has a special reinforced steel cage. Now, it's this kind of cage that has saved Brian's life when stunts have gone bad, but hopefully it won't come to that tonight. Now, here's how things will work. Brian will go up this steel ramp and hopefully get enough lift to propel himself through that second pair of goalposts, and he will hit his target 300 feet away and set a new world record.
Here's the football field that Brian is going to jump over. It has been constructed in the parking lot of the Orleans Hotel and Casino. Now, not only does Brian need to split the uprights at each end of the field, while airborne, he's going to fly through a series of explosive pyrotechnics. The car that will take to the air is this Chevelle SS, custom built with a special driver's seat made for impact. Brian Carson is 40 years old. He lives in Southern California, and he's going to attempt to break the current world car jumping distance record of 298 feet. If all goes well, Brian's going to pick up speed along this 1,100-foot approach to the takeoff ramp. This is not a perfectly flat approach. There are a few bumps and dips that cause some problems as he tries to get up to 95 miles per hour. If the car follows Brian Carson's intended trajectory, it takes off from the ramp, launches into the air, and has enough momentum and altitude to carry him the distance.
But nothing can top the event that we will see here tonight. And that's why a lot of the folks who are crowding the edges of what is left of the Orleans Hotel and Casino parking lot are a little apprehensive, because they don't know how this will turn out. As a matter of fact, no one knows how this will turn out. And you know, as I look out into the crowd, I think a lot of these folks, like I am, wondering, why would someone take these kinds of risks?
Maybe it's because he was born a thrill seeker. This is Brian when he was 16 years old in a traveling daredevil show that performed at fairgrounds across the country. And here is Brian's first car jump. He went about 50 feet, and for safety protection, he only had on a cheap helmet and a simple lap safety belt.
I set my goal early to be the best at crashing cars at an early age. I mean, I wanted to see how many times you could flip a car end over end and, you know, see how far you could accurately jump a car 50, 60 feet. Or crashing an art car and somersault the end over end. It just got to be a challenge. I flipped one twice. Well, next time I'm going to flip it three times. And the time after that, four times. And it just grew.
His need for distance grew too. If he could go 50 feet, why not try 80? At 18 years old, he did just that. These cars were not modified at all. A single lap safety belt is all that held him in. He tried to go further and add some pyro to the next stunt. He missed the catch cars, took a tremendous impact, and ended up in the hospital.
To be very frank, looking back, I didn't have a clue of what I was doing trying a stunt of that magnitude, because I didn't prepare the car right. There was no cage in the car. I was still just using a lap belt, and even though I had a fire suit on to protect me from the fire, I really didn't know the specifics of the speeds and distances of the ramp, and I still remember pulling my arm from out of the speedometer casing in the car and seeing one bone going left, one bone going right, and, you know, I knew I was maybe getting over my head here a little bit.
He started doing police car jumps because of some work he did on Smokey and the Bandit. The crowd loved it, and he was getting more successful at his jumps. He got to the point where he was doing almost a jump a week, and these were all over 100 feet. But his body was still absorbing the impact of the crashes, so he went to a four-point harness, which holds him in the seat better. The harness helped a great deal in lessening the toll on his body. Next, advances were made in beefing up the suspension of the cars so they'd hit the ramp perfectly.
Now we are jumping 100-foot minimum, close to 150 feet to impact, and we're doing that week in and week out with success. But you gotta remember, all these cars were still basically stock cars. There was still, at this point, no cages in the cars. No roll bars, no cages. I knew I had the jumps dialed in now to where I knew most of the time I could just stick it in there without flipping end over end. I mean, I wore a shoulder harness that was loose. I could always lay down the seat if the car started going end over end. And I would say 75% of the time, I was right on. It's the other 25% of the time that hurt.
Brian was flying the distance that he wanted, but there was room for adjustment in the crash landings. So he started doing sky crashes, which is stacking up a bunch of cars for a mid-air collision. Brian and his crew learned a lot from trial and error on these big wrecks, like using a bungee system to yank him back in his seat. They built fuel cells to keep the gasoline in, and as the crashes got more radical, they put their first roll cage in the car. All these advances were giving Brian the confidence he needed, knowing his body could survive even bigger wrecks. It was now time to go back to distance jumping and go even further. Columbus, Ohio, 1987. This car is equipped with a state-of-the-art roll cage, and Brian is ready to hit the ramp at top speed. The car flew over 200 feet, but end over end is the worst way to land. The roll cage broke apart, and Brian ended up in the trunk. It took over 45 minutes to get him out.
That jump definitely hurt. When it stopped bouncing, all I remember, I was unconscious for quite a while. When I came to, my head was in the trunk of the car, the cage was shattered, and I remember telling myself when I got out of that car, I just shook my hands. I mean, no, I didn't get hurt, I was just knocked unconscious. I said, that's the last time I ever do that. But never say never.
Later that year in Thompson, Connecticut, a stronger roll cage and a longer ramp. He landed just right on the crash cars. Although the car bounced upside down, the roll cage held together and no injury.
So finally we got to where we could dial in jumping three tractor trailers, and that's a pretty good gap. That's over, you know, close to 200 feet. So what was next after that? Of course, after three trucks, you gotta try four.
Charlotte, North Carolina, 1990, Brian attempted to break the current distance record at that time of 250 feet. The car was destroyed and Brian was unconscious for 30 minutes.
The suspension I built was completely wrong. It totally broke apart on takeoff and the car went inverted in flight. And as soon as the car got in the air, I said, oh boy, I'm in deep caca now.
The car hit the end of the last trailer and resulted in a head-over-heels, bone-crushing roll. It took the jaws of life 45 minutes to get him out of the car.
After missing that Cadillac jump over the four-tractor trailer, it was really a matter of pride to me. I mean, I had to come back. We went back to the drawing board and started working with the motor more, the suspension more, and really critical this time was the ramp. Now the ramp started getting major league. It was almost twice the size of our old ramps, and it was new to use it, but the only way to figure out if I had it dialed in was to go off from it.
In Brian's patented trial and error ways, he was ready to go off this ramp in front of 80,000 people at the Charlotte Motor Speedway in 1991. 298 feet, a new world record.
The first time we went off the big ramp was at Charlotte, and we were running at speeds over 80 miles an hour, and that stunt was perfect. It was the prettiest jump I ever made in my life. Everything worked perfectly. It was something I'm proud of.
And that brings us to tonight, where Brian has only 1,100 feet to reach the speed of up to 90-plus miles per hour to hit that ramp and make it to the crash cars.
As far as attempting this stunt at this point in my career, I'm probably, I know I am, the most experienced person to try a jump like this and have the most knowledge of doing it. I've done it so many times, not this distance, but leading up to this distance. The only downside for me is my age. I'm 40 years old, which is a young man, but you gotta remember, it's been 10 years before I did the other jump, and my body doesn't take much to the impacts anymore. So that would be the downside, is the carnage that I'm gonna have to endure no matter how this jump goes.
So after over 2,000 crashes, Brian's body is getting ready for one more big one. Will he hit this ramp right? Will he get the speed to make it to the crash cars on the other side? There's one big red line across this football field waiting for him. The paramedics have told us that it's a 12-minute drive to the closest emergency trauma center in the event Brian is seriously injured. The fire department is equipped with the jaws of life in case the car is so crumpled that he can't get out. There's about 10,000 people gathered here in this parking lot, and this crowd didn't have the benefit of seeing all the previous cars and jumps and crashes that we showed you earlier. I really don't think they know what to expect. Brian's taking a final look over at the playing field. His crew members told me he always carries a towel with him up to the top of the ramp and throws it when he's ready to go. This crowd has been waiting around and is really getting geared up. Brian is ready now and getting into his car. He needs to crawl into his roll cage. His crew helps him get situated and strapped in. At the other end of this field is waiting this ominous pile of crash cars, double stacked for extra cushioning because Brian feels like he's going to hit this set of cars harder than he's ever hit any other set in his entire high-flying career. There's a referee on hand to let us know if the field goal is good, and he will be signaling if Brian is off to the left or right. We've all seen a lot of field goal attempts come right down to the wire for a nerve-wracking ending to a football game, but this is no game. For Brian Carson, this is life or death. Brian's backing all the way up to the wall. He needs every inch to get the speed he needs. Brian's taking a practice run to make sure his engine doesn't misfire and that everything is in working order. It's not a perfectly flat run up to the ramp. There are a few small dips that Brian needs to negotiate. Even off a small dip, he could catch air and have difficulty steering. He's also making sure that the wheels will be perfectly aligned to the ramp. There are 60 catch cars waiting for Brian, and of course the red line that marks his old record of 298, and 2 feet further, the 300 mark, which he's trying to pass. Joe, Ron, are you ready for this?
Oh yeah, we're ready. Don't worry about that. That isn't a question. They keep talking about those crash cars being a cushion.
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out why and how that represents a soft landing.
Well, I guess now it's time to find out. Let's go back to Kevin.
Well, his practice approach seemed to go well. I saw him give a thumbs up to a couple of his crew members, now backing up to the wall. We've said before, he needs 1,100 feet of runway, and he needs every single foot of that space if he's going to complete this record-breaking jump. Brian also told me that when you see him tightening up the gloves, that means he's ready to get after it. He shifts into gear, a look from our end zone camera, and it looks like it's all clear, guys. There he goes. Like he's moving at all.
It's locked again. Brian.
Joe, no word yet on Brian Carson's condition. The jump seemed to go perfectly. His crew is rushing to the car. We still haven't seen a signal from Brian that he is okay. Let's take a second and take a break for a commercial. As soon as we find out some information, though, we'll let you know.
Well, we are still waiting on the condition of daredevil stuntman Brian Carson. And while we wait, Ron, let's take a look at the slow motion replay, see where this stunt went wrong.
Well, let's check it out here. Now he's heading toward the ramp. He's got to get a lot of speed up. Remember, he's going to try to go over 100 yards. Now he's up in the air here. You can see the pyrotechnic explosions going off. He gets the car airborne. And I tell you what, he's got to have a lot of speed to get that thing up there. He's over. And that's one camera that's getting ready to get completely wiped out. You can see from this angle, you can really appreciate the distance he's got to go. We're talking about 100 yards. And then he's got to be straight. He's got to come right through the goalpost, and he does that. Now, coming up here, you see he's got the good distance. You're going to see a red line pop up. Now, that will represent the Charlotte, North Carolina record mark right there, that red line of 298 feet. Now, to me, I think he goes at least 15, 20, maybe 25 feet, Joe, past that. But the question is right now, how's he doing?
And to answer all of our questions right now, let's go back to the Orleans Casino where crews are still working on the wreckage. Kevin?
Thanks, Joe and Ron. During the break, they got some oxygen to Brian. Apparently, he had been knocked unconscious. He'd been out for a few minutes, and now he's back, and he is just hearing for the first time that he has broken the record. Over three. As you can see, Brian's still a little wobbly as he exits the car, but that's to be expected after surviving a 90-mile-per-hour car wreck. The crowd waiting for Brian to pull off his helmet. He does, and they let him know that he has just set a world record. crew member Don Latre is going to make the official measurement from the 300 mark to the initial point of impact. Here's the slow motion replay to officially document the world record. Past the 300 foot mark by 14 feet. Now they're saying 314 feet and 3/4 of an inch is the official measurement. Brian, incredible jump. You set the new world record, 314 feet. Everything seemed like perfection.
I'll tell you, people don't realize how much work this is. It goes into this months of work for a flight of 3 or 4 seconds in the air. It couldn't have been better. I mean, no one knew what the outcome would be until we launched off the ramp, even myself. So I'm a happy camper right now, I'll tell you that. I mean, for me to come out in one piece was a goal, but the second set the record on top of it, it tops it off.
Let me ask you about approaching. Did everything feel right?
I'll tell you, we had limited space out here. We only had 0.2 miles coming to the ramp. And even though we built the car to try to get the speed, I didn't know it until I came to the ramp the final time. About 50 feet in front of the ramp, I knew I had enough speed to get over to the goalpost, but I didn't know I had enough for record. I just floored it and hung on. It flew like a bird.
Well, tell me about that. How does it feel when you're in the air, the pyrotechnics are going off, and you're flying?
On this particular jump, when I got in the middle of my flight, I felt like I could pull back on the steering wheel and kept going up in the air. It felt like an airplane. It really did.
Watch the impact and explain it to us.
Yeah, this kind of gives you a view at home, big time, how the impact was. That was a pretty hard hit, but it worked perfectly the way we designed to come in flat and just crunch through the cars and make it as soft as possible for me.
Brian, let's all get in and go for a ride with you and explain this to us.
Okay, here's it's hammered down. I'm watching my speedometer. I think about here at 60, then 70, then 80. And here's about the point. There's no turning back, and it's just hammered down. We're just approaching the ramp coming up, and here it is. And I'm just hanging on for dear life because I don't know what's going to happen. And bam, we're down. A good day at the office for me.
Great day at the office. A little bit of luck, but a lot of skill. Brian Carson, the king of crash, eclipses his old mark of 298 feet, 314 feet, and we're not going to forget those 0.75 inches that he goes to set the new world record. An incredible night here at the Orleans Hotel and Casino. But right now, let's send it back to Joe and Ron at the Tropicana.
This is Ron Pitts. We're back here at the Tropicana Resort and Casino here in Las Vegas, where we just witnessed stunt history. 3 record-breaking stunts, and of course, the best one is yet to come. Everybody knows who that is. Robbie Knievel getting ready to jump 30 limos. Let's hear it for him, folks. Now, Robbie's father, Evel Knievel, of course, a household name when it comes to this kind of thing. He holds the current record of 20 limos. Now, it's easy to say you're going to jump over 30 limos, but I don't know if you quite have an idea how far this is. Let me take you on a little walk here. You can look behind me and see the distance. It looks a lot different up there than it does down here. Robbie's going to be airborne this entire distance. I mean, we're talking about a distance a football field long. I mean, that's some serious guts right there. Now, Robbie will be jumping over these 30 limousines provided to us by Beltrans Limousines. Now, that's a big order, but Beltrans, biggest limousine company in the nation, so they took care of it. Now, I got to tell you, that's 200 feet of luxury, but for Robbie, he's not going to be worried about that, because once he hits that ramp here, as I walk down to the landing ramp, you can see he's going to be looking at nothing but that landing. That's all he's concerned with, and I got to tell you what, Joe, when you look at it from down here, it is a long, long ways.
Right, Ron. Well, now we've got Robbie Knievel on the Las Vegas Strip, just minutes away from his world record attempt. I've been waiting to do this for days. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for the man Evel Knievel calls the world's greatest daredevil, his son, Captain Robbie Knievel.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to be here with the Tropicana and live for the two-hour Fox special. After 27 years, I've broken all my father's records and I've set a lot of my own records, and I finally conquered those fountains at Caesar's Palace 9 years ago. Some people say I'm the best at what I do, but it's only because I had the best teacher in the world, a man who created his own sport, my father, Mr. Evel Knievel. After looking off these ramps for 27 years, it's now a privilege to be back here attempting the longest jump I ever have in my career for some of the wildest people I've found around the world, right here in Las Vegas, Nevada. I have a lot of jumps planned for the future. We all take risks, but there's positive risk and negative risk, and I'm happy about the professional athletes and sports enthusiasts around the country that bring class back to their sport and take a positive risk for our children. That's all we can do these days. There's a lot of extreme sports, and all we can do is take a positive risk for our kids. I also have seen a lot of great stunts tonight on the show. I have a lot of stunt friends that have been critically injured or killed, and my prayers are with them and their family. And I hope that for 5 more years that I can continue to be the best that I am, to keep the name Knievel the most famous on two wheels. Bell Limousines, you got a lot of guts, because I'm going for it. Hope to see you after the jump. Thank you.
Thank you, Robbie. And good luck. We will be checking in with Robbie in just a few moments. You could tell as soon as Robbie entered the arena, you could feel the drama just heighten here at the Tropicana. Well, the time is drawing near. We are just minutes away from Robbie's world record attempt, so stay with us.
Up next on Daredevils Live, 30 years ago, America watched as Evel Knievel attempted a motorcycle jump on the Las Vegas Strip. The results were bone-shattering. Now, it's Robbie Knievel's turn. Stay tuned for a world record distance attempt. Plus, discover what happens when his stunts go good and when his stunts go bad. When Daredevils Live, Shattering the Records, continues. Welcome back to Daredevils Live, Shattering the Records.
We are back live at the Tropicana Resort and Casino on the Las Vegas Strip, where Captain Robbie Knievel will attempt a new world record motorcycle jump.
Well, you know what, Joe? He told me something real interesting last night about approaching the ramp. He's got to come at it at about 90, 95 miles per hour, but the guy does not use a speedometer. He doesn't want to have the extra weight on there. And the way he knows how fast he's going, he just listens to the bike. He feels the whine of the engine. That's big time. You got to know what you're doing.
Yeah, and it comes from a lot of experience. Yeah,
absolutely. I mean, he's designed his takeoff ramp to give him just enough lift to propel him over the 30 limos. Now, he's got a 500 horsepower bike that will give him the required speed of about 95 miles per hour minimum, and he's hoping that'll be enough to get him to the other side of the limo. Now, Robbie told me last night, again, the point of no return on this thing is going to be about 200 feet from the starting ramp, meaning that once he gets inside that cone, he is fully 100% committed. Wiping out at that speed could definitely be fatal. Now, there's some other risks also. If he can't stay airborne for the entire stretch, he could crash into the limos. Everyone knows that. Veering off to the side, not good also. You're coming down on sheer concrete. If he overshoots the ramp, it works like a pogo stick effect, and it bounces them all over the place. We've seen one of his jumps where that went wrong. And of course, coming up short, as they say, yeah, he hits the edge of the ramp, that's equally hazardous. You know, either way you look at it, Joe, this jump is not for the faint-hearted.
You've got to be some kind of risk taker to even try this, but we know one thing, Captain Robbie Knievel is definitely made of the right stuff. In the 1960s and 70s, the name Evel Knievel was synonymous with outrageous, death-defying motorcycle jumps and stunts. But there was another Knievel waiting in the wings.
I want to meet my son, Kelly and Robin.
At a practice field near Buffalo, New York, 9-year-old Robbie Knievel got onto a 160 Harley Davidson that was three times his size and performed his first motorcycle stunt. Not bad for a kid, but Robbie's jump soon took on a more adult look. 4 years later, at the age of 13, Robbie Knievel cleared five vans in a motorcycle jump and began his professional career as a daredevil, following in his father's bike tracks. Robbie always dreamed of breaking his father's records.
I wanted to be the best in the world, but I never knew I was going to be jumping the distances I am today and have another stuntman say, nobody can touch Robbie.
Robbie started breaking other people's records almost immediately. Legendary Evel Knievel's best was better than the others. 1968, Evel Knievel attempts a jump over the fountains at Caesar's Palace. It was an unprecedented event covered by network television and watched by an audience of millions. Off the ramp badly, loses control on landing and slams into concrete pavement. He broke half the bones in his body and ended up in the hospital for 2 months. Evel's now passed on the torch to Robbie.
I am not the greatest daredevil in the world. I am the father of the greatest daredevil in the world.
Captain Robbie Knievel got his first chance to do better than Dad at Caesar's Palace in April 1989. He was back in Vegas where his father wiped out 20 years before.
I think what boosts me is, ever since I was a little kid and said to myself why I wanted to do this, is because there was 50,000 people in the stands cheering me on. And I said, man, this is what I want to do for a living.
ATCO Speedway in New Jersey, Robbie jumped 180 feet, but wiped out on impact.
All I saw was the pavement coming and me going way past the landing. And I was, you know, as high as the telephone poles, and I just started grinding my teeth, and I just hit, and it just sprung me off the bike, and I broke my fibula, my outer ankle, and I ended up with a concussion. They had to put me to sleep to get the pavement out of my rear end. So I left out.
Then, a near-fatal jump in Los Angeles, California.
In red, white, and blue, like my father was, who entertained so many kids that looked up to him. And he had a charisma, he had an entertainment about him, he was a stunt guy, he was a daredevil, and he was the best at what he did. He created his own sport, and I loved it so much and looked up to him like a superhuman. I got in the business at such a young age. I feel like I have that meaning, but for the kids of today, and plus his fans who still watch it.
Well, Ron, Robbie told me that he does not have a death wish and he hopes to live forever. And he's managed to not have had a serious injury through 26 years of professional jumping.
Yeah, but I tell you what, in a few minutes, though, he's getting ready to make the jump of his life. And now, you just heard the explosion. He's doing the family tradition, wheeling. And I tell you, those wheelies now, that's part of the family tradition of Evel Knievel started, so he does it, and it's a good way for him to warm up as well. He likes to really get into it, get a feel for the bike, get the crowd going. He says, hey man, I'm an entertainer also. You know, this just isn't about me coming out here and jumping. I like to get the crowd into it.
Absolutely, no doubt about that. So many elements to worry about. You have to worry about the weather. He talked to us about the temperature of the pavement and how his bike reacts to the pavement.
Right. You know, last night we thought because of the rain that he was going to have to change things with the ramp and the wind and all that, but the wind died down. There's no rain, so he won't have to make any adjustments. One thing you might want to look for when Robbie takes off, as soon as he leaves the ramp, if his front wheel is too high, he said, I'll have to adjust it. I'll have to cut the bike, as they call it. The way he does that is he stops the back tire, and that stops the centrifugal force of the back tire, and it noses down the bike just enough to make it fly even.
Folks, in a moment, we'll be right back as Robbie Knievel gets ready to break a 30-year-old record held by his father as the great Evel Knievel looks on. The question now, can he do it? At the Tropicana as Robbie Knievel revs his engines, and it's time now for the practice runs as he gets ready for his record-setting jump, 30 limousines over 230 feet, and it's time now for Robbie, Ron Pitts, to get familiar with this track and with this run.
Now, he took about five or six good speed runs in practice this afternoon. The bike sounded like it was sputtering. It almost sounded a little rich on the high end or the low end of the carburation. I went over to him. I said, what's happening with the bike? Doesn't sound good. He says, we're at 2,000 feet elevation. We got to redo the carburation. The thing that could wipe me out the fastest is if I hit that takeoff ramp and I'm sputtering or I'm mishitting on the pipe because the carburation's not right. He said he feels that's the only thing that can keep him from making this jump. That's the worst thing that can happen to you, to have something mechanically go wrong as you come off that jump in midair.
We've talked about it already a couple of times. The weather has been so strange the last couple of days. Yesterday, Robbie was going to make a practice run. The wind was just whipping into the face, right into the face of this jump. Then we had rain earlier today. The wind has picked up as we've gone on here tonight. So really, it's been a constant change with the weather, something he's going to try to have to gauge, I would imagine, right up to the last second.
Yeah, but you know, a bike like he has likes to run in this type of weather. It's cool, it's crisp. That's ideal, an ideal position for him. Now, all he has to worry about, and for people watching this, one of the things you might want to look at is what happens to him as soon as he leaves the ramp. You'll have a pretty good indication as he takes the speed run right there and veers at the last minute. You'll have a pretty good indication, Joe, of how this jump is going to go. He told me he felt like the speed part of it wouldn't be a problem. He feels like he's got enough speed to clear it. But the attitude of the bike, keeping that front wheel somewhere in between level and about 45 degrees. He gets any higher than 45 degrees, he's got a problem because he's going up too high and he's scrubbing off distance.
I have to ask you this, Ron. It's going to happen quick. When he makes the jump, it will happen really in a matter of seconds.
Absolutely.
But if you're watching this either here or at home, is there something to look for to give an indication whether this jump is going well or if it's not going well at all?
Two things is the bike level as he takes off of that jump. Now, he can cut it, like I said earlier. He can stop the centrifugal force with the back tire. That will cause the bike to nosedive a little bit, and he can level it out so he can fly far and not high. Next thing is he going in a straight line? If he comes off that thing a little crooked, well, we've already talked about that. You know, you got the limos down below and you got concrete to the left or right of that. He wants to go straight, he wants to go pretty low, and he wants to go far.
Again, to recap, Robbie Knievel is about to make a world record-setting jump, and he's going to take care of two records at once, the world limousine record, which had been held by his father. He will attempt to jump over 30 limousines at a distance of over 230 feet. These are practice runs he's making.
We talked about it earlier. He's got that point of no return, that commitment line. It's exactly 200 feet from the start of that takeoff ramp. He said, once I get in that cone, regardless of how I feel, I've got to go through with the jump, because trying to abort at that distance, that close to the ramp at that speed, you don't have a choice.
I gotta tell you, I'm new to this world, and and talking about stunts, having a chance the last couple of days to hang around Robbie Knievel, so at ease, so calm. I would imagine you'd be a nervous wreck in the time leading up to this jump. He was as collected as you could be when here tonight, in the next couple of minutes, he's going to risk some very serious circumstances.
You know, it's funny when you talk to the all-stars or the superstars in football or baseball, the top-notch guys are really cool and calm before the big games. You notice they're unusually together and they're not nervous and they're just ready to go. And you see he gets, and that's the way Robbie is. Now you see he's on top of that pre-takeoff ramp, I should say. And that's one thing he was a little bit worried about. He says, I'm always starting off in tight positions. And I got to get, number one, I got to go through my gear pattern. He's got a 5-speed bike. He's got to go through 5 gears and be at top speed before he hits that ramp.
So yet another practice run for Robbie Knievel. And as you might imagine, I would imagine with all of the circumstances surrounding this jump, there's this ambiguous feel. You have to have the right feel before you head down that ramp, knowing that this is the one where you're going to try to jump 230 feet.
Yeah, he said he's gone into a jump and he's planned to take 4 passes, and he's ended up taking 7 passes because each time it just didn't feel right. And let's face it, this guy has got 2 things. He's got the bike and then he's got his heart.
Practice runs, and he said last night he's expecting 3, but as you said, doesn't know how many it'll take to get the right feel.
Right, it's just that feeling. And you look at Robbie's bike, I'm sure a lot of people are wondering, you know, the suspension, what does it take to carry something like that? He went over and gave Dan a little dap there. The suspension on this bike is about as stiff as you can possibly make it. In fact, it's all custom made for him. When he hits the ramp,
like the one. One more look at it.
Well, that time, see, he wants to take that real-time look there to see exactly how far he's going to have to go, what it's going to look like. I got to imagine he's going through a lot of visualization right now. And earlier, Joe, just to finish up on what I was saying about the suspension, he wants it as stiff as possible. When he hits the ramp, he doesn't want a pogo stick up, because like we said, you go up, you're losing distance. He wants to keep it firm and go out.
The crowd out here at the Tropicana, still waiting for the world record attempt by Robbie Knievel. The distance of 230 feet. And 30 limousines here in Las Vegas.
Joe, the wind doesn't seem too bad, but I noticed it's picked up a little bit in the last 20, 30 minutes or so. It doesn't appear to be a crosswind, which is the one that scares them the most.
Thumbs up from Robbie Knievel straight to the camera, which he told us yesterday, once you see that from me, believe me, I am committed to this jump. We'll see if that does indeed happen with this run at the 230-foot jump.
You see that front wheel? It never really went too high. He never got pogo sticked up in the air. He was able to go out, and that was the difference right there. But we talked about the takeoff right there. He had to be in good position. The bike had to be level. And you can see he stayed straight. He's not off to the side. He's right in the middle of the ramp. That is a perfect landing. It looks to me, and he may say otherwise, it looks to me like a perfect jump.
He just cleared the limo, set a world record, beating his father's 30-year-old record. This crowd here at the Tropicana going crazy. Question I've ever asked, how do you feel?
I feel great, man. I always got to say something to the people. The devil never did a damn thing for me, never will. Keep believing in Jesus Christ. God bless you, Vegas.
Robbie, tell me a little bit about the jump now. How'd you feel coming off? I noticed you hit dead center perfect on this thing.
Yeah, I did. I hit dead center. I landed just over, it was 198 feet to the down ramp, and I just cleared it by about a foot, but I wasn't full power tonight. I haven't been out here with any lights, and I had the glasses on, and it kind of gets blurred in the cold wind. You got to have the glasses on, so I wasn't at my best, but like I said, I got 5 years to go, and to keep the name Knievel the most famous on two wheels, and that's what I plan to do.
Robbie Knievel,
you two
congratulations.
Girls aren't
congratulations. We're going to take a final break. More in a moment.
Thank you.
stay tuned for more Daredevils Live, Shattering the Records. The Tropicana Resort and Casino. Joe Buck, Robbie Knievel, Ron Pitts. Robbie, congratulations. Thanks for a wonderful night.
Thank you.
He sets the world record for the limousine jump, and congratulations to all of our other stuntmen on a wonderful night. All of us at Fox, good evening.